It is Friday. It is the 30th of May. You're watching ARIRANG, Korea's only global network. Live from Seoul, I'm Moon Gun-young. Now, although Election Day is still a few days off, Koreans have been, at least some Koreans have been heading to the polls on this Friday. For the first time in Korean election history, early voting an option is an option. Our political correspondent Kim Ki-choon starts us off.
For the first time in Korea's local election history, a two-day long early voting period started this Friday. Without prior registration, voters can cast their ballots from 6 a.m. to 6 p.m. Korea time if they are unable to make it on Election Day, June 4th.
I won't be able to vote on the actual day of the election, so I think this early voting system is very convenient.
Voters are only required to show their resident registration card to cast their ballot at any of the more than 3,500 polling stations set up across the nation.
I think the early voting system is great, as it does not require prior registration. And since the polling booth was nearby our workplace, we were able to vote during our lunch hour.
Electronic devices located in every polling booth recognize the barcode on the ID cards and take the fingerprints of voters. But some voters complained of problems.
It was not easy finding our way to the polling booth. I think we need more signs to guide voters.
For added convenience, smartphone users can download an application that provides information on the locations of nationwide polling stations and the list of candidates in the local elections. Officials from Korea's National Election Commission have been dispatched to each polling station to manage and monitor the voting process. Through the early voting system, the National Election Commission expects the voter turnout this year to be higher than it was in the previous local election in 2010. Kim Young-gil, ARIRANG News.
Meanwhile, lawmakers in Korea's National Assembly have agreed to hold a full and thorough investigation into last month's Sewol-ho ferry disaster. The 90-day probe will begin on Monday. A plenary session of the National Assembly passed the proposal by an overwhelmingly majority of 224 out of 226 participating lawmakers with two abstentions. The agreement comes after days of wrangling between rival parties over whether to include specific names of witnesses in the joint proposal. Now, the main opposition New Politics Alliance for Democracy had been demanding the inclusion of Presidential Chief of Staff Kim Ki-choon. The ruling Saenuri Party insisted on leaving the selection of witnesses to a special parliamentary committee. Now, as a compromise, the two sides agreed to subject presidential office officials to the probe, with the head, Kim Ki-choon, being required to report to hearings. President Park Geun-hye has issued a stark warning. She says that if North Korea makes good on its threat to conduct a new form of nuclear test, it will almost certainly trigger a nuclear arms race in this region. Our Park Ji-won tells us more on the president's interview with the Wall Street Journal.
President Park Geun-hye has warned another nuclear test by North Korea would have a huge impact on the security landscape in Northeast Asia. In an interview with the Wall Street Journal this week, President Park said a new test would have a domino effect, with North Korea's neighbors feeling compelled to develop their own nuclear weapons to arm themselves against such a clear threat. She warned it would be difficult to prevent such a scenario from playing out as, quote, "North Korea would effectively be crossing the Rubicon if they were to conduct another nuclear test." She added, a new test would also make the six-party talks on North Korea's denuclearization irrelevant. She said Seoul was closely cooperating with the other members of the six-party talks on a number of levels. The president singled out China's role in resolving the issue, as Beijing exerts huge influence on the regime. China is North Korea's biggest trade partner, accounting for 90% of the regime's external trade. She added that China has firmly expressed that it won't accept a nuclear North Korea and will take steps to deter Pyongyang from going ahead with another test. The South Korean leader promised to forge ahead with a trust-building policy with the North and seek out ways to boost inter-Korean economic ties. North Korea threatened to conduct a fourth nuclear test in March, following its previous tests in 2006, 2009 and 2013. Satellite images indicate North Korea's nuclear test site has been active and a test could happen at any time. Park Ji-won, Arirang News.
When the latest news meets the latest business stories, we give you a bigger and better picture of the world. Business Today with Moon Gon-young, every weekday, only on Arirang.
Now, North Korea has agreed with Japan to reopen a probe into its kidnapping of Japanese citizens in the 1970s and 80s. North Korea says that if it finds any surviving abductees, they will be returned to Japan. Now, in return, Tokyo says it will lift some sanctions on North Korea and send that state humanitarian aid. Here's our Shin Se-min.
The agreement between Japan and North Korea to reopen an investigation on Japanese citizens abducted by the North decades ago represents a possible breakthrough in a bitter bilateral dispute. The move, however, touched off concerns that Tokyo's unilateral lifting of sanctions against North Korea could cripple international efforts to press Pyongyang to give up its nuclear programs.
"Until the day comes that the families of those abductees can hold their children in their arms, our mission is not over. Since the beginning, we have been determined to pursue this goal and believe that this is a solid first step towards that."
In exchange, Tokyo's chief cabinet secretary told reporters that Japan would ease restrictions on North Korea and consider a resumption of humanitarian aid to Pyongyang.
"We will look into canceling the special sanctions against North Korea and the sanctions against humanitarian vessels from North Korea to enter into Japan."
The international community has had a lukewarm reaction to the deal, including both South Korea and the U.S., which said a wrong message may be sent to Pyongyang. South Korean officials said the lifting of sanctions could have a negative impact on denuclearizing the North. The U.S. State Department spokesperson stressed the need for transparency in talks with the North. Shin Se-min, Arirang News.
So why the sudden turn of events? What would this new agreement mean for the South Korea-U.S.-Japan strategic alliance? And what should be Seoul's stance in all of this? Let's get some assessment for that. Robert E. Kelly joins us live via Skype. Dr. Kelly is a professor of political science at Busan National University. Robert Kelly, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
First of all, this is definitely an interesting turn of events. How did this come about when the relationship between these two countries has been so strained?
Sure. Well, North Korea abducted these people, you know, 30 years ago in the 70s and 80s, and it's been a really big thorn in the side of the Japanese government for a very long time. Japanese civil society has mobilized around this issue. There have been protests, there are family association meetings. I mean, this is a very, very emotional, powerful sort of electrical issue in Japan. There's really nothing like this in Korea. I mean, perhaps you could sort of make an analogy to the comfort women in the same way that it really activates people. And for the Japanese, this is something that really needs to be resolved, right? That's why I'm actually not as concerned about this so much as I think many other people, because if the Japanese can get beyond this, I think they'll actually be able to work much more closely with Korea and the United States on North Korea, because this is so divisive in Japan.
Robert Kelly, this also comes at a time of friction between South and North Korea. Now, in your view, how is this deal going to go down in Seoul?
I imagine that the South Koreans will not want it very much. To the extent that the Japanese are cutting a side deal with the North Koreans, you know, as the Americans today said, it does kind of undercut the united front. I'm not actually that concerned about it, because it's not really clear that the Japanese are going to do very much, because we don't know yet if the North Koreans are going to cooperate. I mean, the North Koreans have not really cooperated on this issue in the past. The Japanese have been talking to North Korea about it for 30 years. So I don't want to get ahead of ourselves. Like I said, I do think it's a very emotional issue. The Japanese do need to get on top of this. This does need to be resolved. So I think we should sort of wait and see just how much the Japanese are going to give on this. If the North Koreans come back with nothing in, say, 6 months from this investigation, then the Japanese won't really change. So I don't think it's a good idea to preempt the Japanese yet and say, you know, they're making a major concession. That's not clear yet.
Well, will this in any way impact the Seoul-Washington-Tokyo strategic alliance? I mean, just tomorrow, there will be a defense chiefs meeting between all those countries involved down in Singapore. What do you expect the three to talk about then?
There will be tension, yeah. Again, I think the general principle with the Americans and the South Koreans has been sort of let the South Koreans take the lead, try to let South Korea deal primarily with North Korea because it's a Korean state, and so Japan and the United States would sort of broadly support whatever the South Korean policy has been. I mean, that's the sort of the general concern. But like I said, this is such an emotional issue for the Japanese that I have the feeling that the Americans and the South Koreans are going to give the Japanese a little bit of space, because this is ultimately something that some Japanese government has to resolve soon. These people are aging. They may still be alive. They may be dying soon. I mean, this is something where there's a time limit. There's a clock. And so my guess is the South Koreans and the Americans will say at the meeting, you know, where are you going with this? How far are you going to go with this? Just how much you're going to release the sanctions? And the Japanese will probably say, we don't know yet, because the North Koreans haven't really given us much. So again, my sense right now is caution, sort of let the Japanese sort of feel their way through this, see if the North Koreans actually come clean, which I really doubt, to be honest. And then maybe in 6 months, if the Japanese are going to make a major concession on humanitarian aid, then we can have a much more robust trilateral dialogue.
All right, Robert E. Kelly, professor at Busan National University, thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you for having me.
Now, Japan and China, meanwhile, as we just mentioned earlier, will play out the next round of their bitter territorial dispute later on this Friday at a security forum in Singapore. Japanese Prime Minister Shinzo Abe is expected to use his keynote speech to urge Japan's allies to work together to counter China's rapid military rise. Our Kim Hyun-bin reports.
At the three-day Shangri-La dialogue in Singapore this weekend, Japanese Prime Minister Shinzo Abe will urge allies in the region to work together to counter the rise of China, while promoting a greater role for Tokyo in security matters. The call will come when the Japanese leader gives a keynote address this Friday evening, citing the heightened tensions in the South China Sea and East China Sea. Abe's top government spokesman said the speech would make the case for constructive discussions towards peace and safety. China has already expressed anger about the Abe administration's move to reinterpret its pacifist constitution. This speech will only stand to anger Beijing more. Led by Vice Foreign Minister Fu Ying, it's expected to describe Tokyo as a real threat to security. The summit involves the United States and ASEAN countries, including many that are involved in territorial disputes with China, like Vietnam and the Philippines. Japan and Beijing also have their own dispute, brewing over a set of disputed islands in the East China Sea. Attention will be paid to the response to Abe's call, as many ASEAN nations are hesitant to take any stance that may harm their economical and political ties with Beijing. In another discussion that is sure to draw the ire of China, the defense minister of Korea, U.S. and Japan will meet on the sidelines of the dialogue for talks about beefing up missile defense cooperation in the region. Kim Hyun-bin, ARIRANG News.
Well, last month's deadly ferry disaster is casting a dark cloud over Korea's still weak economic recovery. Newly released figures for April show that the effect is being felt all across the industries. Here's our Hwang Ji-hae.
The sunken Sewol-ho ferry disaster threatens to wreck Korea's fragile economic recovery. Statistics Korea said Friday that output across all industries dropped 0.5% in April from a month ago. The agency said the drop is largely being seen in the service industry, which includes the leisure and lodging sector, reflecting lackluster domestic demand brought on by the disaster. Service sector production dropped 1% from the previous month, while retail sales were down more than 1.5%. The nation's industrial output, which is less affected by the ferry disaster, managed to grow 0.1% last month, but still lower than a near 1% rise in March. The agency said the gain in the production in the mining, manufacturing and gas industries was led by strong exports of automobiles and mobile phones. And with business sentiment among Korean manufacturers dropping for the first time in May this year to 79 from 82 in April, experts say the outlook doesn't look so good either. The Bank of Korea, which releases the monthly survey, says the slowing Chinese economy and strengthening won soured business sentiment. A reading below 100 means pessimists outnumber optimists. Hwang Ji-hye, Arirang News.
Now, over in the U.S., its economy contracted to start the year for the first time in 3 years. The Commerce Department says gross domestic product contracted an annual rate of 1% in the first quarter, and the government's initial estimate was of 0.1% quarterly growth. However, experts say it's only a temporary setback in the long road to recovery. The forecast, they forecast a robust rebound in the second quarter, fueled by strong demand. Some economists have said that they are optimistic that growth will remain above 3% in the second half of the year as labor market conditions are improving and consumer spending is picking up. Now, right here back in this country, local currency traded at the strongest level in nearly 6 years this Friday morning, but retreated on speculation that authorities intervened to curb the rapid gain. The Korean won closed at 1,021 against the greenback to close the week down slightly from Thursday. The won hit 1,017 at one point during trading, the strongest since August 2008, but took a sharp turn after the foreign exchange quickly erased the gains. Authorities there have been pacing the won strength near the 1,020 level this month as appreciation pressure continues to weigh in. Now, beauty and cosmetic products are no longer solely the preserve of women. The male skincare market is booming and it's Asian men spending the most. Data compiled by market research firm Euromonitor shows that the Asia-Pacific region accounted for 64% of the $3.3 billion market last year. China had the largest share at about $975 million, with Korea sitting in second place at $635 million. When it comes to per-person spending, Korea easily topped that list. Korean men spent just over $25 on skincare last year, which is triple that of Danish men who came in second on the list. The heavy consumption among Korean men is attributed to male celebrities advertising skincare products. Let's now take you to Korea's southern port city of Busan, where the annual motor show just opened to the public this Friday. A car is up for grabs every day during the show, but there's more to take as for what to expect for the future of the industry. Our Song Ji-san gives us a preview.
The bustling city of Busan is now the go-to market for domestic and foreign automakers alike. One out of every five cars on the road in this port city is imported, the highest rate in the country, representing the purchasing power of Korea's second biggest city. That's just one of the reasons more and more automakers are choosing the Busan International Motor Show to unveil their latest models. Hyundai Motor pulled the curtain back on its AG for the first time, a luxury sedan developed to cater to those with a budget between $30,000 to $50,000. Hyundai also unveiled a diesel version of its best-selling Grandeur model to provide customers with more options.
We felt the need to diversify our luxury lineup to retain our customers. We found drivers who opt for larger diesel models are demanding efficiency and practicality. Models made by German automakers are popular, so we launched the first diesel in our luxury lineup.
Vehicles powered by greener engines are worth keeping an eye on.
Among the more than 200 cars exhibited here at Bexco, a noticeable trend emerges in the rising number of hybrid and electric cars aimed at lowering carbon emissions.
Developing and supporting low-carbon vehicles was one of the major issues discussed during the OECD International Transport Forum held in Leipzig, Germany last week, but the lack of infrastructure is still a concern. Automakers are doing their best to address those worries.
The electricity bill is only $30 when driving 1,500 kilometers per month. We are also equipping charging facilities at parking lots in large supermarket chains, so drivers can charge their cars with much less fuss.
Visitors can test drive some of these oil-free vehicles at the expo, and one automobile is given away each day to a lucky visitor. Song Ji-san, Arirang News, Busan.
Now, earlier this week, Korea and Vietnam wrapped up their fifth round of bilateral negotiations on an FTA that the two countries seek to conclude by the end of this year. The free trade pact, when sealed, is expected to boost the already growing trade relations between Seoul and Hanoi. Let's get a quick assessment of business relations and future prospects. Our regular contributor, Dr. Kim Byung-ju, joins us live on the line from Hanoi. Hello there, Dr. Kim.
Hello.
Now, so you are in Hanoi chairing a Korea Mekong Business Forum. Why don't you give us a brief overview of what this gathering is all about?
Right. The Mekong regional countries include five countries, Vietnam, Cambodia, Laos, Myanmar, and Thailand. And this Korea Mekong Business Forum, it had a second gathering this time. And it was originally proposed by the Korean government. The idea was proposed back in 2011. And we had our first meeting last year, and this year, as I said, is the second meeting. Here, businesses and then, business leaders from this altogether six countries, including Korea, get together and talk about different possibilities of cooperating and finding new businesses. And this is a very interesting, venue where all these business leaders from these six countries sit around and get together and discuss different areas here. And actually, Korean government initially, at the beginning, proposed six areas for cooperation. First one is IT, and then second, infrastructure market, and then human resources development, green growth, water development, and agriculture. So we have all these areas where these people can come together and talk about ideas for further cooperation. A very interesting occasion, I suppose.
Right, interesting indeed. Among the countries in that region, we know Vietnam has come quite far in developing its economy through cooperation with Korea and in Korea. What is the current status of bilateral economic interaction between the two countries?
Vietnam is Korea's number six export market here, and trade has been growing quite fast. For the last about 4 years, the trade between the two countries has increased by like four times. And Korea's leading manufacturers such as POSCO, Samsung, LG, they all have their facilities here. And so with those facilities and other smaller businesses that have joined here in the market, Korean businesses joined in the market, I have to say Vietnam is fast becoming second China in terms of like a marketing, manufacturing basis for Korea's, producers.
Second China, you say. Now, what do you see in Vietnam's economic future and your future prospects for Korea's role or place in the Southeast Asian nation's economic development?
You know, currently, because of Korean businesses' presence here in Vietnam, if you list up top six export items, export products from Vietnam, four of them, or even five out of six, have something to do with Korean business. Vietnam's top export item last year was, semiconductors. Second one was mobile phones. And the fourth one was the textile that had a lot to do with Korean business. And the fifth one was the display, electronic display, including TVs and so on. Top items for Vietnam's exports are being produced based on Korea's help here. So it means that we have a very exciting future here, and Vietnam's exciting future in terms of business and economy will have a lot to do with Korean businesses as well.
All right. Well, a very good look there on the bilateral ties between Korea and Vietnam. Thank you so much for that. That was our regular contributor, Dr. Kim Byung-ju, live for us from Hanoi, and we hope to see you right back here in the studio on Monday.
Okay, thank you.
Well, it's getting hotter by the day with the temperatures above their high averages, mostly in the high 20s to mid 30s today. Now, the high temperatures come with this high UV levels as well. So while you are enjoying this nice warm weather, make sure to drink lots of water and go into the shade once in a while to avoid any dehydration and sunburn. Now, also with the yellow dust finally cleared out, we can expect the clear sunny skies across the nation. However, we're still seeing some high fine dust levels in the Gyeongsangnam-do. the province today. Now going over to our temperature readings, Seoul will top out at 32 this afternoon. Meanwhile, the southern cities such as Gwangju and Busan will peak up to 34 and 26 degrees. Now moving over to other regions, Jeju Island tops out at 28, Dokdo at also 28, and Mangkhamgang tops out at 22. Now that's all for me this hour. I'll be back with more updates in the later newscast. Back to you, Kanyang.
All right, thank you, Michelle, for that, and thank you for watching. That is your business today on this Friday, and do join us again at 6 p.m. Korea time, an early edition at 6.